Hello, welcome to InSight. I'm Wendy Brokaw. What is drag and why is it called by that name? And why is it thriving despite all attempts from the earliest times in America to right now to ban it? Why does it continue then and now to be important to society as a whole? And what about all those elaborate costumes, exaggerations, the wigs, the props, the backgrounds? What are the parts of a drag performance? And what's it like to experience one? We're going to find out. Would you please welcome my guests, queer artists Jessica Rehfield and Richard Arias, Jr., also known as RiRi Caliente. Hi. Hello. May I call you RiRi?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, thank you so much for being my guest today. You know, Salem Art Association is featuring an exhibit that you were responsible for bringing into being, The Art of Drag, at the Bush Art Center from July 5th through August 25th. Jessica, you curated the show and Richard was lead consultant. This exhibit, and I quote, explores the work of drag queens, kings, and in-betweens who create the community that supports and protects itself while bringing their art into the world. What is drag and why is it called by that name?
Well, thank you so much for having us too, Wendy. We're thrilled to be here.
It's
a very interesting exhibition that's going to be opening, and it is called The Art of Drag, which RiRi is a drag artist, so we have The Art of Drag. And drag as a term, so in my research as the curator, I've been reading about the histories of drag. It goes back a long ways, and there's not really a conclusive reason that it's called drag. There are conflicting answers. Some have it as an acronym, D-R-A-G, but we don't know for what. Some people say there is a theory that dresses that dragged across the floor. There was a term that it might have referred to, dresses dragging. There's also an interesting theory that there was a gay slang language in the 50s in England called Polari, which was a made-up language that was used within the queer community. And it kind of used words that they made the words sound different than they usually were pronounced. And so drag might have been one of the ways that they changed some language. But it's not really known exactly why it's called drag. At least that's what I've found out in my research.
Same here.
Yeah,
definitely.
Tell us, Jessica, about the exhibit. What does it contain?
Yeah, so this is going to be a very immersive exhibit. If people have been to the Salem Art Association, the Bush Barn, we are in the upstairs. It's the largest space. Yeah, so we're very thrilled to be there. And the exhibition, we want people to get a sense of what drag is as an art form without necessarily having to go to a drag show to get the sense of that. So we have props, we have dress forms that will be sporting some wonderful variety of dresses that we've collected from multiple people. We have wigs, other props that are used in the production of drag, crowns, fans, and then we also have a series of interviews that we did with a number of the drag artists that were kind enough to participate and give some of their words. And they also were featured in a very beautiful portrait series. So people will be able to learn from within the experience of people who do drag, what it was like for them to become drag artists. And then we also have a series of performances. So people can come and see drag performed in this space that we're creating. The space, I've been taking great care to include elements that will make it a transformative experience for someone who comes into the gallery space.
Thank you for bringing some of these props and pictures with you today, and fascinating. So, tell me, when are these going to be?
Yeah, so we have the opening is July 5th from 5:30 to 7:30.
And I'll be performing that night.
RiRi will be performing there. We have a drag art soiree July 12th. We also have three special performances, July 26th, August 9th, and August 23rd. And those are performances with a drag performer and then a question and answer session afterwards. So it's a special opportunity to be able to ask questions and watch a performance.
Well, thank you for that. Can you tell me, why is Salem Art Association supporting this exhibit?
So Salem Art Association has worked with me as a curator and an artist for over a year. I was a resident artist with their artist in residency program. And I produced some work during that residency that unfortunately was targeted by hate speech. Ooh. As a queer artist, this is something that we're always, you know, looking out for. However, Salem Art Association really stepped up and they supported me as an artist, and then we've worked together for over a year to produce more queer art programming because that was their response. If they encounter hate speech, they felt that it's appropriate as an organization to show the community that hate speech isn't tolerated. And then they also gave the opportunity to me and to other artists to be featured. I've curated another show for them called Queer Love that happened February of this year. So when they had the idea, Salem Art Association proposed the art of drag. I think they're thinking about the current climate and that there are people in the community who are drag performers. There are people in the community who are queer, and we need to see more representation. So Salem Art Association offered this, and then I am curating it.
And how did your partnership with RiRi come about?
Well, I'm pretty sure what happened is that I went to some drag shows and I was already tasked with having the job of curator for the show, and I approached RiRi. And I think I came up and I said, "Hello, I'm Jessica. Would you be interested if I proposed a show that I'm curating and it's about drag? Would you want to be participating in that?" So I did approach you, and I approached a few other people to ask if you'd be willing to be consultants, because you kind of know a lot. Mm-hmm. And particularly about what's going on in the Willamette Valley drag scene. So we talked about it. Anything you want to add to that?
I remember it like it was yesterday, even though it was so long ago, it seems.
It's over
like we've
a
been
year.
Working really around this time last year. And I was right after a show, Jessica came up to me and had this idea, and it was something that I had never heard before, something that was different. And I also immediately thought, wow, what a way to get people to know more about drag and understand more about drag. So I said, yes, sign me up. Absolutely. Whatever you need, I'm ready. Let's do it.
I went back to SAA and I said, they said yes. We're doing it.
Drag has been around in one form or another since ancient times. When did it begin in the US?
So in the research that I've done for this exhibition, I came across an account of one of the earliest known drag artists, we could say, because there isn't a lot recorded, but it is recorded that a person named William Dorsey Swan was known to host drag parties in Washington, D.C., where his home was. He was a formerly enslaved African-American person. We don't know what his gender identity was, but he hosted drag balls, and they were very unwelcome. He was arrested several times, and he kept hosting these drag balls. He's also one of the first people recorded to refer to himself as a queen of drag. So there was a raid on his home in 1888. It was supposedly his 30th birthday party. There was a ball, and he was thrown in jail, and that is how we know about this, because it's recorded in his arrest records.
Wow. Tell us about Dragon, Oregon. What are its roots, and what are its Willamette Valley roots?
Yeah, interestingly, we do have a lot of Dragon, Oregon. There is a place in Portland that was founded in the 60s, Darcel 15 Showplace. So that's pretty well known now. It's very famous now. But at that time, it was still kind of an outlier. And that's one of the first places that I know of in my research that drag was happening in Oregon. There's also an organization called the ISCWE, the Imperial Sovereign Court of the Willamette Valley Empire, right? Yeah.
Imperial Sovereign Court of the Willamette Empire, yes, which is a division of the Imperial Court System, which was founded in the 60s. And Darcel 15 actually is Darcel 15 because she was voted Empress 15 of Portland, and so that's where the 15 comes from. Every organization has, they run it as a British monarchy, so you have an emperor, an empress, a prince and princess, like, so there's a whole court, and the idea behind it is to raise funds for nonprofits around hometown and, you know, other places as well. But Willamette Valley, that chapter was founded in the late 70s, I think it was 77, 79, around in there. Mm-hmm. And that's an organization that I currently am a part of, and they've been going strong ever since 77. I myself was elected Empress 40, and spent the whole year just traveling all over the country trying to raise funds for other nonprofits and for here in Salem.
And they use drag, the organization uses drag performance and drag events as a fundraising.
And that's, yeah, it started with the drag shows, and so the drag is definitely a common thread throughout the fundraising. We've done other things, you know, like car washes and book drives and things like that, but drag is always alive and present in the fundraising.
And what are your own roots? What made you decide you wanted to become a drag performer?
I grew up in the theater, so I'm a community theater kid since I can remember. I've been performing under some spotlight one way or another since I was about 2 years old, and my big contribution to the arts was being involved in community theater, and I had written and directed plays, and I thought, okay, well, it's probably time, what else can I do with this talent that I've been blessed with? And so I said, you know what, I made a deathbed promise to my best friend, who made me promise him, will you please try drag? You're born to do drag. And this was in 2003 when he, you know, I had played around with it in the 90s, but it wasn't really anything. I wasn't ready. So the time came around 2012 for me to honor that promise. And so I had a coworker who was involved in the ISCWE and said, hey, we could really use somebody like you. You know, if you're as good as you say you are, then we could definitely use somebody like you to help fundraise. So
challenge.
So I challenge accepted, and went, and I performed, and ever since then I've been going strong in one way or another. I was, you know, Miss Southside Speakeasy for 3 years, and in that time I raised about $33,000 for local nonprofits, and then I went on to be Miss Gay Salem, and then I went on to be the Empress, but always somehow, title or no title, involved in fundraising.
RiRi, what do your performances involve?
My performances involve so much. One thing is emotion, lots of emotion. I sing live as well, so sometimes if I'm feeling the need to say something with my own voice, I'll sing live. But usually it's me just dedicating my emotion, my, you know, the physicality, everything to the message of the song, whether it be something about, you know, hey, it's party time, or there's a message or something that I want to get through, whatever it is, I make sure that I make the eye contact and make the audience feel like they're involved in the storytelling.
What do you hope people will take away from your performances?
I hope they have an opportunity to, whatever they may be going through, whatever, you know, they may be experiencing, whatever place they are in their life, I want them to be able to take them on a trip with me, maybe have them escape. You know, when I produce a drag show, it runs anywhere from an hour and a half to 2 hours. I want to make sure that the audience that comes in has that escape, and they have something that they can take home with them and say, oh, you'll never believe what I saw. Whether it's me, whether it's a fellow drag performer, as long as you take something away from it that you, or makes you want to come back, or maybe even makes you want to pick up a brush and start doing drag. Just as long as, you know, I make that connection. It's very, very important to me that I make that connection.
And speaking of connections, how are you connected to the drag community locally?
With a coworker who helped me in 2012 get established here in Salem, I started going to shows and fundraisers and quickly became known. At that time, I was known for my acrobatics and dancing and... Yeah, so now we're at a point where I need to get a new hip because of it, so...
It's for a good cause.
So I had that energy coming, just excitement. You know, I always say, I ever since my heel hit the floor, I never, ever have stopped. And so I just keep going and going and going, and because I just... There's just so much to say. And so... You know, whether I've, you know, acquired a title from the court system, or just I have an idea about a show that I want to produce, or just, you know, producing my shows on a monthly basis, I've just always made sure that the community was, you know, present and involved in some way, because I love the community that I live in, and I want to make sure that there's not a lot of representation here, and I want to make sure that what they do see is absolutely mind-blowing and inclusive, all-inclusive.
How do you support and protect one another?
Well, I have my name, RiRi Caliente. During the pandemic, I was named the Mother of Salem because I have about... so many. I have about 12 drag children. So I'm considered the mother of Salem because I have about 12 drag children, and that can be drag kings, queens, and everything in between. These people fall in line with the passion for the art form, the passion for fundraising, the passion for art in general. So I feel like that familial sense is just built in to protect one another. If there's a place where we're doing drag for the very first time that's never had a drag show, my first question to the venue owner is, will security be available for us? Because in this day and age, unfortunately, this is one of the big questions that we have to ask. And so it's more of a buddy system a lot of times, and just loving one another and wanting to see each other protected and safe and well.
Do you see greater acceptance in society in general for drag performance?
I do see that's a tricky one, because you can be tricked into thinking that everything is great and wonderful because there's so much visibility on television with drag entertainers now, and drag culture has become such a huge I don't know, just a huge topic, whether you're for it or against it. It just seems to be constantly on people's minds and in their viewer. So I think there is, to a degree, I think there is a lot more visibility. But as far as, you know, there are some pockets of the community that want nothing to do with it. And for whatever reason, whether it's they don't understand it or they have their own, you know, bias and you know, religion tends to play a large part in, you know, and it's been my understanding in being on the receiving end of some of that hate is just a lack of understanding and exactly what the art form is. If you're looking at it on TV or if you're looking at it, it can become a very narrow mindset. But when it's in front of you, you know, I've had people come to me after shows and say, wow, I didn't know that this was what this was. Thank you for opening my eyes. And so those people tend to come back to new to more shows, and then they tell their friends, like, oh, this isn't such a scary beast after all. It's actually pretty fun. And that's the whole goal, is to show folks that, hey, this is no different than, you know, going to see your bestie who's headlining in a play somewhere, or, you know, going to see one of your friends who has a band. You know, it's
performance.
It's performance. It's art. And it is what you take from it. There's so many things that you can take from it. And ultimately, that's, you know, why I place so much importance on that connection, because I want to make people think and, you know, educate, inspire, all of those things, because it's so fun.
Have fun. So what are your hopes for this exhibit, both of you?
I guess I hope people will come with an open mind, but if they don't have an open mind, I hope their mind will be open by the time they leave. It's very important for me that people see drag artists as human and also as artists, that there are creative people making these costumes and characters and performing, and that there's a lot of love that they give with their performance. And the beauty that we're trying to share through the exhibit, I hope that they feel that.
I think I can't add anything to that, because it's pretty much the same.
Oh, yes, you can add something.
I definitely, all of that.
But yeah, let's start that. Can we find out from you what one of your performances is like right now?
Absolutely. Why not?
Let's do it.
Let's do it, yes.
Let's do this.
I would love to.
RiRi Caliente.
Yes, thank you.
And thank you so much for being my guest today on InSight. And thank you for joining us today on InSight. I'm Wendy Brokaw.
Their glitter, the winds grow colder. Suddenly, you're older, and all because of the man that got away. No more his eager call. The writing's on the wall. has run off and undone you. That great beginning has seen a final inning. Don't know what happened. It's all a crazy game. That old time thrill, for you've been through the mill and never. The same. Good riddance, goodbye. Every trick of his, you're on to. But fools will be fools. It's rougher, it's lonelier and tougher. With hope you burn up. Tomorrow he might turn up. There's just no let up. The live long night. Looking for the man that God.